Dean, are you ready?
We are ready. Sue is not ready. She's getting a more comfortable chair, but we can start with the minutes and such.
Yeah.
All right. We'll, Commission is ready. We'll bring this start at approval of the summary minutes of October 15, 2013 regular meeting. Is there any discussion or questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the minutes.
I'd move the minutes be approved as published.
First and second, any discussion? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Same sign opposed. Motion passes on approval of amendment. Next item up will be public hearing items. Number two, conduct a public hearing receiving comments and address questions from abutting property owners regarding the proposed annexation of the West Grand Avenue and the bridge over Dry Creek west to the flood control levy.
Dry Creek.
Okay, the image that we have on the screen there, you can may ask John to zoom it out a little bit, but our dashed red line is our city limit line, and we'll kind of give you the lay of the land first, and then we'll give you the purpose of the hearing today. But historically, the center line of West Dry Creek here is the city limit line, so east of the bridge, the center of bridge east is in the city, center of the bridge west is outside the city. In 2004, due to concerns about fire protection, non-potable water, other issues out here, the City Commission authorized a project where a water line was extended down West Grand. And we have a requirement that if you are a beneficiary of city water service, you need to be inside the city limits. And so this property here, which at the time was owned by the Kerr family, this property here, which was owned by Craig King and King Industries, and this property here, which is the home of Twin Oaks Industries, were all annexed into the city, but just the parcels themselves that were receiving city water and fire protection were annexed. The road itself was left in Saline County. Recently, there was a concern that arose about the condition of the bridge over Old Dry Creek there, and it was determined to be a shared city and county issue in terms of repair of that bridge, and so the city and county shared in the cost of making that repair, and as a result of that agreement, there was a decision made that the city would be asked to diligently pursue the annexation of the roadway from the bridge all the way out here to the flood control levee. And just by way of historical note, there was an agreement that was entered into, not well documented, but that when this levee was put in, it cut off access from the west on Grand. And so the county asked and the city agreed that because it was easier to access West Grand by going through the city off of Broadway, the city agreed to maintain that roadway by maintaining, meaning apply gravel as needed, do any needed plowing, those types of things, and that agreement was in place since about 1958. But this would take it a step further, and this would involve the city actually annexing the roadway portion in to the city, and we would have ownership and also jurisdiction. And by jurisdiction, if there was a complaint about somebody speeding or there was a traffic accident in the roadway, the City of Salina Police would respond to that if this annexation occurred. The properties themselves that would remain outside the city limits, if there was a break-in or a theft call or something like that, the Saline County Sheriff would still respond to those So by law enforcement jurisdiction, we're just referring to traffic regulation. The purpose of the hearing today is to give potentially affected property owners notice, an opportunity to appear before the Planning Commission and register what their position is, because there is not right-of-way for the full width of Grand Avenue there along the south side. Each one of these owners here, Hedges, Twin Oaks, Ben and Lavelle Frick, Hickson Landbauer Investments, Caldwells, and Wells, their property holdings extend to the center of the road, and the city cannot annex any portion of their property into the city limits if they object to that. So the purpose of today is to explain that to interested property owners and to the Planning Commission, make a record of any comments or concerns about those, and see if we would be successful in pursuing that annexation. I might pause a second and let Dan Stack indicate for the commission and property owners. We've semi been maintaining this road for a number of years. Do you see the city's role changing in terms of maintenance or anything upon annexation, or it would be basically what we've been doing since 1958?
Yeah, we do not see it changing at all, and yeah, we believe it'll be continue the same or similar types of maintenance that we've done over the last 50-ish years, I guess. Is that about right?
Yeah. Okay. So that would consist of blading if needed, applying gravel if needed, plowing snow if needed, which supposedly the city's been doing anyway since 1958, but this would actually put the roadway within the city limits for all other aspects.
We've added some millings the last few years to try to help with dust, and yeah, this is one of the roads we definitely try to maintain because it serves quite a few businesses there and is not just a rural county road. It seems like it has more traffic that we have to work on, so it's hopefully something that we'll continue to address as necessary.
Dan, does the city staff receive any money of the real estate taxes for those businesses out there?
That's a good question. I guess I wouldn't.
I think Mr. Oaks could answer that for you, but
if they're in the city, they do, yeah. But not in the, I don't exactly.
This Twin Oaks Industries, by being inside the city limits, they pay the city's property tax mill levy, so they are contributing property tax to the city. The same would hold true with King Industries. So everything that you see outlined here in red, they are subject to the city's mill levy, and they are contributing to the city's property tax base. These other properties here that are outside the city limits, they would not be subject to the city's mill levy or jurisdiction. So what we pointed out for you was some of the history here, where the city actually de-annexed a piece of property right here that was owned by the Wells family in 1991. In 2004, we pointed out that the city went out and annexed these individual parcels as part of a waterline project. And so what we are looking at here is that no portion of any unplatted tract of land shall be annexed by any city without written consent of the owner thereof. And so we've got properties on the south side of Grand that are outside the city limits. They're unplatted. They're zoned heavy industrial. Some of them exceed 21 acres. Some of them don't. And so the city's position on this is that we are willing to pursue the annexation of that roadway, but it is subject to the consent of those owners that we pointed out on the south side. And this hearing is to first of all ask any questions you have about annexation to staff, and then allow any of the property owners who are here to address questions to the commission and staff to see if we can settle any concerns or questions that they have.
Any questions for staff? Seeing none, this is a public hearing. The commission will take no action today, but we do want to hear from anybody who's interested or has any public comment. If you would address the podium, state your name and address for the record. We'd love to hear from you. This is an open public hearing.
Come on, Barb.
Hi, I'm Barbara Young, 1100 West Grand, with Hickson Lambert. My question would be this letter that we received, traffic control. There's no posted limits. When the bridge was being repaired, the county engineer said they had some traffic, that they did a traffic count, and some of the speed limits they said were around 98 miles an hour. I don't know if that's where you count that figure, but I know when you come out of here on West Grand, right by the bridge, you have to be really careful. So I'm just wondering how the traffic control will work on this.
Okay, I'll let Dan touch on that a little bit about what the posted limit would likely be, and I can touch on enforcement also.
Yeah, we did have a speed trailer out there to try to help with the any speeding or any vehicles that were going through the construction zone, kind of for the safety of the workers. We can check what those numbers were. I don't remember them being particularly outlandish. Did you say 90? Is that what you said? Yeah, we can check into that a little further and see. The typical speed limit would be 30 for most everywhere around Salina. So we would have to, if we take over this road, then it's 30 miles an hour unless we designate it otherwise. Is that fair to say, Dean?
Yes, unless there was a posted sign out there, the enforcement would be at 30 miles an hour. And what we wanted to clarify, the main difference is today, if it's unannexed in its state and you think somebody's speeding or driving recklessly, the county sheriff would enforce. If the roadway is brought into the city and there are complaints, then the city of Salina Police Department would enforce.
But yeah, we can definitely put the speed trailer up because it was, I don't know if you noticed, but it wasn't functioning very well at the time. So we'll try it again at some point. We'll check the counts, and if we see anything that's a problem, we can put it out there again and get a better count at this point. But yeah, if it becomes a city road after a certain time once it's annexed, then we have to put the signs up and do the enforcement thereof afterwards.
This is a map that our city surveyor prepared, and it's one of the reasons it's difficult to see is just the scale that it's at. But he has written a legal description of what would be annexed, and what would be annexed is a 50-foot wide band that would be 30 feet from center line on the north and 20 feet from center line on the south, and would leave all of, this is your property, isn't it, Barb, right here? So it would leave that in its present state, unannexed in the county. This property is owned by the Caldwells. This is owned by Wells. This is owned by the Fricks. And then you have Twin Oaks Industries. And then the Hedges Trust or Hedges Sign has this last property here. If none of those property owners register a written objection, then the city could proceed to annex that. And we actually have a form over here by John where the owners who are present here today, if they have no objection to this after hearing the report today, they could sign that form indicating that they don't have any objection to having the roadway portion of their property brought into the city. So I think the primary change, there have been questions about taxation. There have been questions about regulation. There have been questions about law enforcement jurisdiction. The law enforcement jurisdiction would change from county to city, even though this strip is part of ownership of those properties. Generally, the county appraiser does not assign it as any tax value because it's subject to a road. So it's not like Barb's going to wake up and she's going to get a tax statement that says we're applying city property tax to this 20-foot strip there, because the county appraiser is going to have it at a zero value for tax purposes. So there should be no impact there, and there would be no impact in terms of land use regulation. The zoning and any enforcement out here would still be under the jurisdiction of Saline County. So it is primarily the roadway that we're discussing today. And as a planning commission, you're used to annexations that are initiated by property owners asking to be brought into the city. This is a case where the city, at the behest of Saline County, is actually initiating the annexation of the roadway. So that's the purpose of the hearing, is to hear from the owners and see if they have any questions or concerns. So the appropriate thing to do would be to see if any other property owners in attendance have any questions, and if there are none, then the chairman could close the public hearing, and there's no formal action that the Planning Commission will be taking today other than making a record of today's hearing and who appeared and spoke for the benefit of the City Commission. So I don't know if Tim or anybody else has a question or comment.
My name is Tim Oakes. I'm at 2001 West Grand, Twin Oaks Industries. My biggest question is, if somebody decides they don't want this, then what happens there?
Well, the agreement between the city and the county says, as structured by the city attorney, says that the city will diligently pursue the annexation of this roadway. And the city's position is that if a landowner or landowners absolutely object to the city annexing this property, then we cannot annex it over their objections. So the purpose of the letter and the purpose of having this hearing is just to have an opportunity to explain to the owners, to see if they're satisfied that this action won't really negatively impact them in any way other than changing who's in charge of the road. And our hope was that everybody would see it as either not a negative or neutral and sign up. So, but if there is one owner who vehemently objects, then the city would not be able to annex that full stretch of roadway, and it would remain in the county, and we would report back to the county that we diligently pursued annexation, but we had property owners who objected.
And for the record, my vehicle won't go 90 miles an hour, so.
Tim, from Twin Oaks Industries, is this a positive or a negative?
Very
for your
positive. I mean, I've been out there since 88. We've had some trouble in the past, not recently, but, you know, back in 88 when we started out, you know, the city would say it was the county. The county would say it was the city. The city's done a great job with it over last, I would say, 5 years, so. But I wouldn't want to see that situation come back again, because it was tough. You know, it'd get to where it was almost impassable. And, you know, we've got full semis coming down there 6-7 a day. And we just don't want to get in that situation again. So it'd be very positive for us.
All right. So. Thank you for your time. Anybody else for the open public hearing who'd like to make comments? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, bring it back to the commission for discussion and or questions for staff.
The only comment again we have is we have a sign-up sheet over here by John, and there's a listing there of all the property owners along the south side there, and there's a place for everyone to sign if they don't object. And so if those present today are comfortable with this, we'd like them to sign the consent form before they leave, and then we'll report the results of this hearing to the City Commission. If we get all the consents in place, then this item will go on to the City Commission for consideration of annexation with the results of this hearing attached. So with that, if there's no other questions or comments, the chairman could close the hearing and we could move on to the next item.
All right, we'll close the hearing and thank you for everybody attending and for your participation in there. Make sure you sign that over there if you're interested in having that done at the table by John. We'll move on to application Z13-6 and we will have a staff report. Dean?
You know all the background detail in this, having looked at this several times and not being completely having a unanimous view from the Planning Commission before, but this relates to the discussion about storage sheds in the non-address side front yard on residential corner lots. And we worked through that to a degree with the commission. We have a draft text amendment, and basically the summary of that reemphasized that while a building permit is not required for a storage shed 120 square feet or less, it proposed that a location permit still be required for that, and we allowed for a accessory building with a floor area equal to or less than 120 square feet to be located on the non-address side of the front yard. I think it's important to note there that we're not talking about 10 by 16s or 20 by 20s. We're talking about a 10 by 12 or smaller, provided that the yard area is enclosed by a 6-foot high solid screening fence. The building does not exceed 10 feet in height at the peak of the roof. And then there was language in there about accessory buildings exceeding 8 feet in height must be compatible in design, appearance, and materials with the principal structure. I'm not sure, or city commissioners who were concerned about just opening that doorway, whether they really looked at all the content of the ordinance, but there was much discussion amongst commissioners and questions of staff at their consideration of this item, and they voted to return it back primarily to look at the thresholds of when and where residential storage shed should be allowed on the non-address side of a residential corner lot, including should there be minimum setbacks, building height limits, which we had, aesthetic standards, which we believe we had. And then there was further concern. We had discussion about not allowing storage sheds to be located in utility easements. And then there was a further concern about just what the definition of front yard was. So I'm going to walk through those one by one, and I may ask John to call up specific ones, but we'll start with this one. If we took the ordinance and applied it, this is probably the right size. It is not behind a 6-foot screening fence. And one of the questions or concerns that planning commissioners had was just where on the lot that could be. Does it have to be in the rear portion? Does it have to be opposite the house? Could that or should that be tied down further? But this probably complies in terms of being compatible with the house. It does not comply in terms of being behind a 6-foot screening fence. And then you've got to look at the location, whether pro or con, you think that is an acceptable location for it to be in. But the one thing that we didn't really address was, does it have to be in the shadow, the footprint of the house? Does it have to be a minimum setback from the property line or fence? we've got some structure height limits in there already, and we've got some size limits in there already. And we think our aesthetic standards are fairly consistent with what we apply elsewhere. So I think the two things to focus on is, do we need to further narrow down the range of locations where it could go? Is there anything we can do with the fencing requirements or should do? And then, is there a minimum distance it ought to be from the fence line or property line? So, John, we have the graphic that is kind of a layout of the lots that shows corner lots. And so, what we're... this is the area that we're talking about here. And basically, we're talking about this area right here is the area that would potentially be eligible for sheds. And should it be even more limited than that, to being limited to being beside the house or being behind the house? Or we'd ask to get some input on that. And then we need to have some further discussion on placing sheds in utility easements. And then we'll get to the other front yard side where there was a concern about that. So I think the best thing to do would be to discuss and consider these one at a time and see if commissioners had any thoughts about further narrowing down the area over here that sheds could be located, and if there should be a minimum setback that sheds should be from this fence line or property line. I think I can't speak. I think with half their minds, the city commission was interested in going ahead and approving this. On the other hand, they were a little bit worried about opening up a real can of worms for the front yard type sheds, and was there a way to tighten it up so it wasn't quite as big an opening. But I guess I'll start by seeing any thoughts planning commissioners had about where within this area right here sheds ought to be allowed.
I guess my first question would be, if we do take action on this and send it back and they approve that, will the sheds that are currently non-conforming be grandfathered in?
Exactly.
That is one thing that they would have to address. My answer would be no. My answer would be that the rules that get written, the sheds that conform with those rules would, we've got different estimates, but let's say there's 100 of these out there today, none of which are legal because they all lie in the front yard. They're not allowed at all today in the front yard, and if we did strict enforcement, every single one of them would have to be relocated or removed.
Okay.
So what this would do is allow or essentially legalize a certain percentage of those. It would give a path for some of the others to make theirs legal, and then there would be some that no matter what you came up with would not be legal. So, John, do you want to go to the one on Ellsworth or perhaps the one on South Ohio or Louise Lane?
While that one's coming up, Dean, is there some concern that if we put in a mechanism that, say, if it's behind a six-foot fence and yada yada, that more people will decide to do this than already have? Is that a concern that they had?
I don't think so. The current city commission is very concerned about the aesthetics of the community, and I think what their concern was that if it is allowed, or if this exception is created, that it be an exception that would not detract from the appearance of the community or residential neighborhoods, and everybody's going to judge that a little bit differently. But if this amendment got passed in its present form or even a slightly, this shed right here is not legal. It's not legal because it's not behind a 6-foot screening fence. And it could be made conforming if somebody put a fence in and said, oh, I'm going to fence in this yard just like that, then that shed could be made conforming. But today, even if this amendment got passed just the way it is, this is still non-conforming. So part of it, it's not to reduce work for staff, but it's to recognize what the desires are of corner lot owners are in the community and recognize that and try to make that exception as attractive and fitting in with the neighborhood as possible, but we're not going to get every one of these to where they would be conforming, because I don't think we would suggest a text amendment that would allow this to be done like
it's
that.
It's probably also an easement, is it not?
It could be in terms of an easement going to the side there.
Right.
But right. So does everybody understand that aspect of it, that if we just hypothetically said we have 100 of these around the community, every single one of them's illegal, we could draft a text amendment that could get adopted that might make 60, 70, 75% of them legal, we're still going to have 25 of them that they'll either have to do something or remove them because they're not going to be legal even under the text amendment. But we can't grandfather this because it never should have been there in the first place.
Well, my feeling is that at the length that we flesh this matter out, we've come to a pretty positive step forward. It maybe not, doesn't complete every problem, but just putting up the fence went a long way towards satisfying the aesthetic concerns. And I think you get the permit part of it in place and let that roll for a few years. It addresses all new construction that's going on. It'll be more of an issue for those that already have their violating fences. And I think a half a dozen years, people begin to learn what the new aesthetic is. But right. I think you can push it too far, both by making it an enforcement problem, both for the staff and for making 100, 200 people unhappy because you've got to go out and make them change their fences or build one.
We attached, and we did our best to try to articulate Mr. Welch's concern. And, John, that was related to the one over at 1101 Stack. And his concern about this was that we have a house that faces Ohio that's just to the north of this, and the way this is located, it is pretty well, could say it influences their front yard view or their front yard on right. on Ohio. So I may ask you again, John, to flip back to the allowable location map. We'll have to keep flipping back and forth. But if you took this right here as a house facing Ohio, we've got a shed kind of tucked in this corner right here, and that kind of influences the view out there. So one of the discussions that the commission had previously and the city commission did less so is there a minimum setback, or is there something that you would want to see from this property line or from this property line here that today on a side yard, this, well, if this was a rear yard right here, the shed could not be located closer than 5 feet to this property line here. That should be 3 feet here, but it's not easy to enforce, and that could be included in the ordinance, or maybe you think 3 feet is still too close and it ought to be farther away than that. But today, if you're on this lot, You can put a shed in that's 3 feet from your neighbor on the side and 5 feet from your neighbor on the back. But over here, under the ordinance draft that we did not say that from this fence line or property line, the shed had to be set back so many feet. And so that was one of the options that we had in there on page 4 of your report, that you could modify your recommendation or modify the draft amendment to set some minimum setbacks there if you thought that was appropriate.
You know, when I listened to the city commission talking about this, it seemed to me like they were more concerned about the front yard and having sheds actually, by our recommendation, they don't want to see a house that you have a 25-foot setback from the street, a house setback 60, 70 foot, and us allowing them to put a shed in the front yard 25 foot off the front curb. I seem to be like they're more concerned about the front yard than they were the non-addressed.
Yeah, the addressed versus the non-addressed, right?
The addressed side is what they were concerned about, a shed being stuck up there. The verbiage of maybe having that, making sure that they have to set it back at least as far as the house.
Right, and so that's why I've divided this report up in three sections. Section one is we have a draft text amendment about corner lots and sheds on corner lots. Is there any tweaking that you see that could be done? The main tweak that we potentially see would be to set some minimum setbacks from the property line or fence line. The second aspect, they were concerned about plugging the loophole on smaller storage sheds being located in utility easements. We've discussed that previously with the commission, but there wasn't a consensus about doing an amendment to eliminate that. They asked the planning commission to revisit that issue, and then they asked if you shared the concern. And what Mr. Bossmeyer's talking about is that the way our front yard is defined, it's essentially defined as the front 25 feet of your property. And I grew up in a house that had a setback of 150 feet from the street. And the zoning setback was 25 feet. So theoretically, if this house was tucked way back here under our definition, you could put a storage shed or something between the front door of the house and the street as long as it wasn't within the front 25 feet. And one of the questions the city commission had for the planning commission was if you share that concern or think that's an unintended loophole or consequence, would you be willing to work with staff to initiate an amendment that would not allow that to occur, that would either redefine front yard or redefine front yard for accessory building purposes?
Does that include other structures, gazebos, fountains?
It would include all of those things that are presently not allowed within a front yard or front yard setback area. The flip side to that, and one of the reasons for that, if you visualize landscaping, especially at some of our commercial establishments, if you think about Kohl's store, if you think about Target or Sam's Club or some of those places, the city's landscape ordinance requires front yard landscaping, meaning a landscape buffer that's between the street and the commercial property. Well, for our purposes, we tell developers that means that's the front 25 feet of your property. If you said the front yard is anywhere between the front of the building and the street, and then Sam's Club said, well, we're going to put a little strip of landscaping up in front of our store 220 feet from Marketplace, and we're going to pave out to the edge of the street, then you've kind of lost your impact there of having front yard landscaping by allowing them to say their front yard's 220 feet away. So we think that there is a way to get there in terms of
modifying the definition of front yard for setback purposes. I don't have a photograph of it, but as I mentioned, the house I grew up was setback 150 feet from the street. There's another house there, and they have a detached garage that's about halfway between the front of their house and the street, between their front door and the street. And it's technically legal, but it looks really bad.
And I think I was on the opposite side of this, sending this through. And to tell you how far I am off on it, I believe on the corner lot, the non-addressed front yard, I would never allow a shed in there at all. And I believe on the other one where the non-corner lot is, the only difference I see there is I would pull those back to about a 40-foot setback or a 35. I don't believe a shed at any time should be equal to the front of the house at any time, even if it had screened. But that's my personal opinion. I would never do that. I would never put a shed equal to the front of my house on a non-corner lot. And if I did do it, it definitely would be screened. And on the non-front yard, you typically find those on high exposed arterial streets or highly visible streets. And they're putting those sheds out that are very visible. So I'm so far that way that that's what I feel. So
right. And if everybody is Planning Commission and City Commission or a majority are in that position, then it, as we pointed out in our report, then it would fall to staff to basically say, well, we got about 150 of these to deal with that were put up illegally. We'll start enforcing. But the idea was that in some cases people don't even notice that there's a shed right here because it's not very tall and it's tucked behind a screening fence, and you'd have to look really hard to know that it was there.
Go ahead, John.
I think if you're going to allow fencing to come in within on a non-code side yard, if you're going to allow a 6-foot privacy fence to be taken clear out within so many feet, what is it, 3 to 6 foot from the property line?
You can take it to the property line.
So you take it right to the property line. You're not really adding a whole lot of blocking that next person beside you's view with a 10-foot shed over a 6-foot fence. I don't know that I disagree with you, Todd. I'd like to see people put their sheds back behind the footprint of the house. But I don't know that you can restrict them if you're allowing a 6-foot fence to go up to clear out to the front of that neighbor's front yard. Mm-hmm. Then how can you tell him he can't put a 10-foot shed inside his fence?
I have to agree with you, Commissioner Bossmeyer. I think that's the same point I made. Once the fence is there, that's the biggest aesthetic element, and yeah, as long as the shed is not overly tall,
let's restrict the fences.
I think we've gone as far as we can with this issue at this point. I'd just like to leave it alone. There might be an issue for a discussion for another day to talk about the front setback and the redefinition of a yard. But
well, I think out of all those points, the main thing that we would want to get from planning commissioners today is, if you're comfortable with the text amendment as drafted, do you see any benefit to saying that the shed has to be separated so many feet from this fence line or so many feet from this line right here?
Not to me, and in fact I think it could make it worse. It's closer to the fence that reduces the visibility of an object behind it.
So you think having it close to or next to the fence,
John, you want to go to...
There was a concern in some of the dialogue about
1103 McAdams.
Leaves collecting in there being some kind of maintenance issue behind the shed.
And I don't know the exact... This is probably like 2 or 3 feet from that. Mm-hmm. For the most part, if you took the draft text amendment and applied it to this, that would probably be legal because it's behind a screening fence. It doesn't exceed 10 feet in height. It's the right dimension, 10 by 12. and it's aesthetically, it's pretty compatible with the home on the property.
Well, I guess my question would be, is if you live on the house that's behind that shed that's facing, what is that, Ohio Street?
Yes.
Oh. You don't see that as being a huge difference between a 6-foot privacy fence and that shed in your front yard?
It's a pretty big shed. What is the size of that shed? That looks more than a...
Supposedly 10 by 12, not requiring a permit.
10 by 12, but now you're, have you discussed height?
Well, the height limit proposed in the draft ordinance is 10 feet.
10 feet sidewalls or 10 feet total height?
10 feet at the peak of the roof.
Peak of the roof.
That looks above 10 feet.
I believe that shed's about 10 feet tall at the peak of the roof.
Is it?
I'm just saying that if I had lived in the house directly behind that and purchased it, and 2 weeks later somebody built that shed in my front yard, that would concern me.
I'd probably be more upset about the fence because it's right up, it's on the property line too, and it runs as a barrier all the way across the side of my yard. So I'd be angry about that to begin with, let alone the shed.
I think though.
I wouldn't buy the house.
I think that the fence by itself, however, would be less, I agree it's an obstruction, but less distracting than the shed. There's kind of a cumulative effect there. Fence adds to it,
and that,
actually.
Part of that, I mean, it can be part of looking at plats and things like that, but we have a number of locations. The way that our ordinance is set up, if you have a corner lot, you have two front yards and two side yards, and the side yard minimum is 7.5 feet, and we have a number of corner lot homes that are set back 25 feet from the property line here, or sometimes greater, but on the so-called backside, they might be 10, 12, 14 feet from the back of the house to the property line, and so part of the reason for allowing fence in the non-address side is if people have pets or gardens or things like that, and they want to have a fenced-in area, it's this area here between the sidewall and the street that provides about the biggest yard area that's usable on their property. So I believe that's part of the reason we're seeing those, and there's no requirement for you to change or modify your original recommendation, but if that's where you're at, then we do want to just move on to the next 2 points and discuss utility easements and then the modifying the definition of front yard. So I guess what we would ask, Mr. Chairman, is to see if there's any members of the commission that would like to initiate an amendment of the recommended text amendment we already have put forward. And if not, then that would be a decision by the Planning Commission to submit the same recommendation.
Do I have a motion for any different recommendation than what we've sent before, or are we in agreeance then of sending it back to the City Commission as presented previously?
Well, I think this the work that we've done already was a pretty good compromise between all of the grievances that sheds and fences were creating. So I think we've fleshed this out as far as it needs to go right now. The commission has concerns about deeper front yards and the definition of the side yards. I think we should bring that back another time for more consideration and some different perspectives. Are there that many homes that are backed up that far? And, you know, what kind of inventory of that is there to consider? And I don't have a real keen sense of what the definition of a yard is anyway, so I'd like to hear that put in a little more perspective for me, but not at this time. So I would make the motion just to see if it flies, that we return this back to the City Commission in the form that it is, and and just move on.
I have a motion, looking for a second or any other discussion.
I'd second that.
I have a motion and a second. Wally Story. I have a motion and a second. All in favor indicate. Or should I take discussion for that, or am I taking for, am I looking for a pass? Any other discussion on the first and the second? Everybody clear on that? We're sending the text amendment back. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Same sign opposed. Aye. Motion passes.
Okay.
Then the next question is, would you be willing to have staff bring to you or at your initiative a amendment, what amendment would look like to close the loophole on placing sheds that don't require building permits in a utility easement?
I had a question about that, and I started to call Westar and didn't get it done, but in the past, my question would be, has that been an obstruction for either Kansas Gas Service or Westar?
From my personal experience, yes. And the in their, whether you're talking to our Director of Utilities or to Westar or Kansas Gas, in some cases, you have some smaller buildings that are 10 by 10 that are even placed on skids, but even being placed on skids doesn't necessarily make it easy to move. So my recollection was a townhome lot over on Martin. We had a power outage in the neighborhood. Some people had put a 10 by 10 shed on skids, and they had placed it almost underneath a power pole in their rear utility easement. Westar wanted to effect repairs. They told everybody they couldn't make repairs until this shed got out of the way. We had to locate a tractor, and then we got a tractor and we got it hooked up to the shed and pulled it out of the easement so that Westar could get access to the pole and make the repairs.
And Dean, this was the city that did that?
This was the city that did that because Westar called us, because it's, realistic or not, it's Westar's expectation that the city is going to protect them and their easements from encroachment. Mm-hmm. And one of the misnomers with the language that was passed in 1991 is it allows people to put sheds in the easement, and they can place it there at their own risk. Except the problem is that almost all the risk goes either to the utility provider or, in some cases, the neighbors who can't get their service repaired because of somebody's shed. And so, in theory, you could go out there and you could ring the doorbell and you'd say, we're ordering you to relocate your shed so we can repair this power, and it's at your risk if it gets damaged or whatever, that's on you. But their response is going to be, we don't have the equipment to move that shed. And so the city had to get their hands on a tractor that would move it.
And I presume we can't grandfather in the violations that are out there.
This particular amendment, because there was language that didn't require it, any shed that was, if this went effective, it would only be prospective, not retroactive. And so one of the reasons we're discussing that is that we're already, as part of this amendment, we're saying, as from this point forward, if somebody wants to put up a 10 by 12 or 10 by 10 shed, they have to get a location permit from the planning department and show where they're going to put that shed. And we sure would like to be able to tell them that they can't put it in a utility easement. Mm-hmm. But in order to do that, one word needs to be taken out of the ordinance, and that's the word building. And if the ordinance just said, that structures that don't require a permit can be placed in the utility easement. That would allow things like dog houses or doll houses or things like that, but it wouldn't allow sheds because sheds would require a permit. So we put in your packet something that we put together and have put in water bills and things like that that says how well or how much you know about your property, where we've tried to do education about what our easements are and where things can be located and what the owner's responsibilities are for both right-of-way and easements. Yeah. But that was the question that part of this being sent back was, there didn't seem to be a majority consensus among planning commissioners that the loophole or exception that allowed for smaller sheds to be in utility easements to plug that loophole as part of this action. So one of the questions they had and staff would have was, do you want to consider an amendment to that section that would not allow 10 by 12s or 10 by 10s to be placed in a utility easement?
Obviously, I'm not a fan of rules and, you know, leaving things flexible for the average person seems desirable to me, but and I think people have a right to do stupid things and fail and stub their toes, but and we voted against this last time, but you know, where's the discussion, guys, if you want to change this or not?
Well, I was going to say that in a utility easement, it seems like there's potential for saving a lot of grief from such stupid acts if we make that amendment fixed.
What's the difference between a utility shed, though, and a fence? I would guess a fence is going to impede some repair work much quicker than a utility shed, and so it seems like if we just ban utility sheds from easements, that's only getting a small bite of the apple. And well, at the same time, I'm not a fan of having one property owner have a fence followed by 6 feet.
How they're anchored or tied down or the foundations they have in terms of moving them, it's certainly a lot harder to get them out of the way than it is to take down a panel of a chain link or wood fence in terms of how they're anchored. They could disassemble the panels on a fence a lot faster than they could move a shed that's on a concrete slab or on a permanent foundation, because only a small number of these are actually on skids where you can move them. Most of them are permanently attached or on a permanent foundation.
So this is going to be part of the placement permit.
It would be part of the location permit. That what's proposed as part of this amendment is that one of the reasons we are where we are today is that for years historically it's been in the building code that if I have a shed that's 10 by 12 or smaller, I don't need to get a building permit. And if I don't need to get a building permit, I'm not going to come down to City Hall or ask anybody or be advised about where I can place it, as opposed to somebody who applies for a building permit. They're going to have to submit a site plan, and they're going to have to locate it in a location that meets all the zoning requirements. And the reason that we have all these sheds in the front yards is because no permits were required for them, and so there was nobody to tell these people that they couldn't put their shed there. And so we're proposing to eliminate that by saying, regardless of the size of the shed, you've got to get a location permit and put it in an approved location. And staff is suggesting that if somebody comes in and they want to put a 10 by 12 shed up in their yard or 10 by 10, we would like to be able to tell them that they can't put it in their rear utility.
And I think at that prior time, I liked the idea that the homeowner, the taxpayer, had a chance to decide for himself, but there was still the opportunity because of the permit requirement for the city to have some sensible dialogue with the individual. So I kind of liked that format, preferred that option for the homeowner. Let him decide, but be informed.
Most of the time, like I said last time, most people don't know what a utility easement is. You know, they know what it is, they just don't know where it's at. And if the city informs them, it may be easier for them to make a decision not to put it there.
Yeah.
But I think if they want to, they'll feel like they really realize that that easement is
right.
They have to set it back.
And would say
amazing,
that
amazing, but I believe that's true.
And would save that homeowner a lot of grief. Come back and reinstall cement footings and move that structure.
Yeah. Dean, is there some sort of to get for both of them, just to gain them knowledge for what Carl is saying? Is there a form when they fill out the permit that they could sign that says I've been notified that not to put it in a utility easement, and if I do choose to put a utility easement and it ever needs to be moved for any reason and the city's involved, that they have to pay, they'll be charged or a fine will be assessed or something like that. That way, now they get to make the decision. It creates Carl's thing that says, let me put it there if I want to. It's my property. But in return, it protects the taxpayer because somebody had to pay for that tractor and there was time involved to remove that. I know if I lived in the city and my electricity was kept off for 24 hours because Carl put a shed in there and they couldn't get down there, I'd probably be pretty ticked off.
That's just my opinion. We have this in your packet, which is our proposed location permit that we would have people fill out. And one option would be we've got a thing here already that says by signing this permit, the owner and contractor accept full responsibility for the proper placement of the proposed shed on the subject property. There is the potential to put on there or add something on there to have them acknowledge that if they decide to put it in a utility easement, they're doing it so at their own risk and may be ordered to relocate it in the event that utilities need to be accessed. That is the option. So what we're saying is we're going to have to meet with these people because they're going to have to get location permits. We're going to tell them what a bad idea it is to put their sheds in a utility easement. We'd rather tell them that it wasn't legal to put it there. What I'm hearing from you is that some of you are saying that you'd like us to just tell them it's a bad idea and let them still have the final decision.
I think it ought to state there ought to be an expense. I mean, talk about the expense will be charged to you for the removal of this building.
On commercial you can't put stuff over utility easement. You shouldn't be able to do it on a residential. Because if something breaks, a sewer line or water line, you got a real problem.
Yeah.
So this period in the sentence just don't allow it.
I'm in favor of not allowing it. The utility easement is there. Yeah. I love Ken Kennedy said a comment once that I loved that said, I don't like looking at poles and wires either, but I don't like the alternative of not having electricity less. And
yeah.
I think it's the same concept on there is yeah. I'd love to be able to use every square inch and foot of my yard, but the utilities are required for me to live what I want to live, and therefore they need to access them in a time of emergency. Therefore, I lose my right to put my equipment on top of their equipment. That could cause a problem. So, again, I seem to be the minority.
What it comes down to is the decision of this board should be made for the majority of the people, not the minority.
Just vote on it.
The majority. Right. What I you mean, well, all the action would be is, are you willing to authorize staff to write something up for you to look at language that would address building and utility easements? That's what the city commission is asking you to do, is to revisit it by authorizing staff to present something to you on some possible changes to that section.
I'm looking for a motion from the commissioners for them to draw up an amendment for us to take a look at a future date around sheds and utility easements.
I'm wondering if, I mean, I'm not sure I'm hearing, maybe I'm not hearing this correctly, but if the staff is going to draw revision language to the statute, then don't they need direction about whether we want to make it legal or optional?
Well, we could draft up an amendment, and you could decide you don't like it and don't recommend approval of it. But
the amendment you're wanting to draw up is making it illegal to put that in there. Is that correct?
Right.
Yes.
And it seems...
we would draw up would be an amendment that would take the word building out of there and say that the only things that you can put back there are structures that don't require a permit, period.
If the chairman will accept the motion that was priorly stated, I would make that motion.
What is that? I'm not clear. Carl?
A motion that basically it's illegal to...
To allow staff to prepare and present an amendment to Section 42582 dealing with placement of storage sheds and utility easements.
To draft it and bring it back to us for
approval. To draft it and bring it back for your review.
That's the motion on the table.
And I would second that.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Same sign opposed. Motion passes unanimously.
We have one more, which is the whether you would like to initiate a text amendment that would look at options for defining front yard differently or defining it in a way that would not allow a storage shed to be placed in the, between the front of the house and the 25-foot setback line.
It needs to set behind the front footprint of the house or something of that verbiage. I agree. You can't leave that wide open.
Set behind the house.
So behind the house or the 25-foot line?
Even if it's on a side, if it's on a corner lot.
Well, there's a house on Marymount that has the storage sets right on Marymount
Road.
Right
on the side of the house.
That's the ugliest thing you've ever seen. And then if it's a metal building, it's worse.
Yeah.
So I say no.
So what,
are you talking about a non-corner lot now?
No, we're talking about non-corner lots, and we're talking about the address side, and we're talking about the front door side of the property. And what we're talking about, and this came up in the BZA case on Brett, where the Dentons had a house, and their house, the way it was set back like slightly over 35 feet from the street. And their front building setback line is 25 feet. And one of the things they're trying to say is that we could legally put a shed between our front picture window and the 25-foot building setback line the way that front yard is defined today. And so when that was explained to the city commission, they were concerned that under the current definition that we have, if you've got a house with a 40-foot or 35-foot setback, it would be conceivable to legally place a storage shed between the front door, front address side, and this building line, depending on how. And so they asked staff and the Planning Commission to look at a possible text amendment that would eliminate that scenario. And what Mr. Bossmeyer suggested was probably the way that you would have to go, is that instead of looking at this as a fixed line, you would have something that said you can't place a shed between the front line or the front of the footprint of the house and the street. Doesn't matter if it's set back 55 feet or 35 feet or 30 feet. You can't put a shed there, even if it's outside the
front.
But
you could you could apply for a building permit to put an addition on the front of the house that was nothing but a storage room, like a garage, if you have that much space between the front of the house and the building lot.
If it was an attached garage.
Right. Yeah. So it's an attached shed. And it's attached exterior storage room.
Are there developments in Salina where one house is set back 50 feet, for example, and the house beside it is on the 25-foot setback?
No. Not very many, except
but
where you've
it
got...
But that could happen,
yeah,
could
that
it not?
That could happen.
Yeah, no, I can
okay.
name
so,
some of the older areas or along Marymount, you've got some staggered setbacks there.
What Wally's saying is I don't disagree with that, that if you said just making force behind the back footprint of the house, that would have to be covered on the side, on the corner lots, too. You'd have to do the same restriction on the corner lots, and those people may only have 10 foot in their backyard. And that's the only restriction, that's a problem we would have with that, is you say it has to be behind the back footprint, then the corner people on with a non-addressed side yard or front yards would have no place to put a shed behind their house, maybe. It is a possibility of that.
This only would deal with the front yard or address side of the lot. So like we have lots out on Tasker Lane and Berkeley Lane that back up to Schilling Road. And technically they have two front yards, but they can declare the Schilling Road side as their backyard, and they can legally have a shed back there, even though it's a front yard on Schilling Road. What we're talking about is a situation where my front door, my front yard faces Marymount, my house is set back 70 feet from the street, and I want to put a shed up between the front door of my house and Marymount Road that's outside the 25-foot setback line. Is that a scenario that you want to see? If it's a scenario you want to eliminate, then an amendment that would say you can't put a shed between the front building line of the actual house and the street it fronts on would eliminate that scenario.
I think that's probably a good something to look at. Yeah. So do we need a motion for staff to draw up an amendment for our approval at a later date, basically allowing them to draw up that does not allow a shed to be put between the front of the house and the front property setback. Is that correct, Dean?
Yes.
In an addressed front yard,
correct.
Addressed
front yard.
What we mean by front yard.
Anybody like to make that motion?
Or that's still okay. Because you're still behind the front of the house.
Yes.
You know.
Yes. If we talk about an addressed front yard.
The front of the footprint, you're all right. On a non-addressed corner lot, too. If you say behind the back of the footprint, then the guys with the 10-foot backyard would be hosed. So the way your verbiage is going right now, that applies to corner lots also. Because it's still going to be behind the front footprint of the house.
The way the motion is set up, we're only talking about the address side.
Right. That was my reason. Mm-hmm. The reason for my question. Yeah. But the language is important there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As to is a motion.
I'll second that motion. That I just heard you make.
Okay.
Done.
Sue, do you need clarification on that?
Okay.
So I have a motion and a second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Same
aye.
Sign opposed. Hearing none, motion passes.
We hope everybody will have a good Thanksgiving holiday. We will meet on December the 3rd. We have an application that was filed by George Stein and his Broadway mini storage to do another project over on South Clark Street, south of South Street, which is a mini storage in nature. So that's become the preferred address for RV storage and mini storage, and he's got a plan for a vacant lot over there. And we've got three items that will probably roll into January and not December, but they're items that we are discussing. We explained that it was an inadvertent omission to take dog boarding kennels out of the ordinance in the C4 district, and we do anticipate that Soggy Dog Salon will be submitting a conditional use permit application for introduce a boarding kennel concept across the street. We have jokingly say that we've looked at about 18 different locations, but the Montessori school that's currently housed in Christ Cathedral is looking for an independent site, and they have looked at existing buildings, they've looked at new construction, and we anticipate them filing an application for new construction for a location that would come before you as a conditional use permit. And then we've had some discussions about either an expansion or removal and new construction for the Town and Country
veterinary clinic at Schiphol and Fawn to either increase its size or to build new over there, and we're working on a pending application for that. But none of those three do we see coming before you till probably your first meeting in January. So we'll have some cleanup business for the December meetings, and we'll staff will see what comes out of the various forums we've had on special assessments, but we certainly appreciate everybody on the Planning Commission being aware and involved in that discussion. Everyone's opinion and position is important for the commission to hear on that, so I thought there was some good dialogue and discussion on that question, and we'll see. Staff will execute what the policy is, so we'll try to keep the Planning Commission informed.
Perfect. Anything else? Any other business? If not, we're adjourned.